Hey everyone, I know it's been a long time since I've appeared again, but I don't know if you can tell, maybe you can, but I got a new camera. It is the Panasonic G7K, or DMC G7K for anybody who cares or wanted to know. I was very fortunate to be able to purchase this because my mom looked out XYZ, and she knows I'm really trying to make film my only career as time goes on. So I'm really thankful, and if my mother ever sees this, thank you so much and I love you. Today I wanted to actually talk about a book, and I wanted to start getting more into talking about books because I'm an avid book reader. I love reading books. That's all I fucking do. It actually excites me to go buy a book. I don't know, I'm a weirdo. I have a lot of books. I still have a box here that I haven't unpacked full of books because I need to get like a certain bookshelf. But anyway, I'm rambling. Yeah, so I thought it would be a good idea and something different, or it felt different for me. So I'm just gonna hop right into it. And the current book that I am reading now is called The Mastery of Love by Don Miguel Ruiz, and I remember that because for some reason I really fuck with his name. I don't know what's wrong. And it says on the bottom here, it is a wisdom book. I don't know if you want to see it up close and personal. Yeah, there you go. So wait, I'm waiting to see it get focused again. Okay. It's so weird because this camera is so beautiful. But anyway, yeah, so this is the current book that I'm reading, and the way I got into it or fell into it is because, you know, I'm currently on a journey to improve myself and attain all the things that I want and need out of life in order to be happy. So at my current job, I was talking to one of my coworkers, Unique. She saw that I was just like, you know, like stressed out one day and stressed out about how things are going to be for my future, XYZ. Long story short, she recommended this book to me. Sorry, I'm wondering if it's still... I got excited because she was gone one day, and I actually picked up the book and read a few pages, and I realized, oh wow, these are really wisdom-filled type of books, and I think I could gain a lot out of them just based off of a few pages that I read. So, and that one was called The Voice of Knowledge, but it's the same author. And I was impressed for some reason by what he was saying. And sometimes people say things and you've already heard it before, but somebody else will say the same exact thing and it just for some reason clicks. And that's pretty much what happened with him. There's nothing in here that I didn't already kind of know, but it's just the way that he paints a picture and tells a story that is beneficial and made sense. And I'm currently working through it, and it's already transformed my life. Okay, so the first step is I'm going to talk about what the book in general is about overall and give you some background information about the author too, because it's really connected and it will make more sense if you get a sense of where the author is from and what he's about. So The Mastery of Love is of course about love, but as you would probably already assume in today's society and climate, it's also mostly about self-love, which is what it all wraps up in the end. But he still brings it up throughout the entire book. It's just, once again, he's a good storyteller. So yeah, it's about human society and how we have this master in our mind, or we're the master of ourselves, right? We're all individually gods. We're all a part of this universe, but we're all with a disease. We all are infected because we tell ourselves these things. We tell ourselves these things that we're supposed to be, how we're supposed to act, how we're supposed to feel and think. And it's all a part of this dream that we're trying to create for the betterment of our lives. Whatever it is, I want to be a doctor, I want to be a lawyer, whatever the fuck. All the things that we do and tell ourselves are all because we have this dream made up in our minds that we want to achieve. But unfortunately, a lot of people end up failing in love and in life in general because we tell ourselves these things, these lies. We tell ourselves that I have to look this way in order to get this man, or I have to do everything this person tells me to do in order for them to stay in my life, or just all these things that just aren't true. And wrapped up at the end, it's pretty much understanding the power of loving yourself and how loving yourself allows you to spread love to others and eventually opens up another's heart to love freely like you do. And that is how you become connected with someone, whether it's a brother, a sister, a lover, a parent. That's how it is. You have to give love in order to fight hate. And it sounds really basic and simple, like some Martin Luther King shit, but the way I'm going to go through this book is going to be chapter through chapter. Every single week I'm going to go through a chapter and explain to you what he means, what he's talking about, and how you can apply it to your life. I don't know if I did a very good job at explaining it, but it will, and it may sound real basic, but as I go through it, I hope you guys will start to understand how I became attached to this book and why it's now currently making my life better. So I'm going to read a little bit about what the author's background is, and it's kind of cool. I actually really appreciate it. Oh, this lighting, bruh. Okay, so it says, Don Miguel Ruiz was born into a family of healers and raised in rural Mexico by a curandera healer mother and a Nahual shaman grandfather. The family anticipated that Miguel would embrace their centuries-old legacy of healing and teaching and carry forward the esoteric Toltec knowledge. Instead, distracted by modern life, Miguel chose to attend medical school and become a surgeon. A near-death experience changed his life. Late one night in the early 1970s, he awoke suddenly, having fallen asleep at the wheel of his car. At that instant, the car careened into a wall of concrete. Don Miguel remembers that he was not in his physical body as he watched himself pull his two friends to safety. Crazy, right? And I believe that something like that could happen, and, you know, whatever. Stunned by this experience, he began an intensive practice of self-inquiry. He devoted himself to the mastery of the ancient ancestral wisdom, studying earnestly with his mother, and completing an apprenticeship with a powerful shaman in the Mexican desert. His grandfather, who had since passed on, continued to teach him in his dreams. In the tradition of the Toltec, a Nahual guides an individual to personal freedom. Don Miguel Ruiz, a Nahual from the Eagle Knight lineage, has dedicated his life to sharing the wisdom of the ancient Toltec. And yes, individual to personal freedom. That's how reading his books feel like. It feels like you're becoming more free as you allow your heart to release things and let go. That's the biggest lesson that I'm getting from this book, is learning to let go, is learning to not take things personally, and realizing that most of the time when people do terrible things to you in relationships or in life, it's because of them. Even in a situation where you know you're right for being upset at someone, it becomes a situation where you have to realize that I'm upset at this person because they're not fulfilling a certain need of mine. Which, love is not about fulfilling needs that you have carried since you were a child. You know, I'm mad at this person because he's not giving me the attention that I want. And it's fine for you to be mad at that person. It's fine for you to be upset that he's not giving you the attention that you want. On the other hand, you can't force him to give you what he doesn't want to give you naturally. And you shouldn't really be mad at him, you know. You can be mad at the situation, but being mad at him is not going to make that man give you attention. What it really comes down to is you making a choice, making a decision, and not being fearful of making that decision, and realizing that with you giving love and loving yourself, you'll know, okay, this man's not giving me attention. I have to make the hard decision to basically be like, you know, this is not going to work. I don't hate you, and I'm not angry at you, and I'm not going to take this personally. I'm choosing to not take this personally. I'm choosing to realize that this just isn't what it's supposed to be, because it should be a natural thing. But because it's not a natural thing for you to give me attention, and I know that I don't want to force you to be somebody that you're not, I'm going to walk away from the situation. That is love. What's not love is you making somebody treat you the way that you want to be treated, with them not really feeling happy giving that to you. Some people will change for you, and that's what they want to do. They're making that choice because they love you, and they think that that change is not that great. They think it's something that they can do, and it doesn't feel like a chore or an obligation. It feels like love. But then other people they change themselves, but they don't really want to do it. But we're taught in society that that is what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to change for your partner if you're not pleasing them or making them happy. But if it doesn't make you happy to make that change, it looks like you guys probably aren't meant to be tied together. So I didn't mean to go on that rant. The first chapter is called The Wounded Mind. Did it? Ooh. Sorry, I'm still new at this camera. I'm acting ridiculous. Okay, so it's called The Wounded Mind, and I'm trying to find a way to jam-pack this and make it concise. But he pretty much talks about how the entire human society is infected with a disease of the wounded mind. We're all wounded individually, because when we're born, when we're children, we're being exactly the way we're supposed to be. We're pure. We laugh, we have fun, we play. Even when we get angry, we usually get over it very quickly. But he also talks about when we're born as masters. We're born as masters of love. We're born of even of masters of anger, jealousy, and sadness. And he does a really good example of how we become a master of anger. For instance, he says, when you're a child, you cry and you get a reaction, people come up to you and you get what you want. And then you try it again and it keeps happening. So now you know that whenever you get angry, you're more than likely going to get a reaction. Obviously, when you're older, you're not always going to get the reaction that you want. But as a child, you tell yourself in your head that if I'm angry and I show anger, I'm going to get what I want. So that's how you become a master of an emotion. And we do that with every single emotion. Master of sadness, master of anger, XYZ, master of jealousy. But the only thing that matters and that helps us to progress in life, in relationships and in careers, whatever, is to become masters of love. Unfortunately, we live in a society where there's more sadness, there's more anger, there's more hate, and those are being practiced more than love. And the more that those emotions become built up and you become this person and you become a master of those negative emotions, it becomes much harder, much, much harder to become a master of love. It becomes hard for you to open your heart up freely to people because we're all defensive. We're all have wounds and we're all afraid of our wounds being touched. It's another thing that he says in here. Even an interaction with a stranger on the street, you could ask them for something, but you're afraid because in the back of your mind, no, I'm not gonna ask her because she's probably gonna be a bitch, or she's gonna probably be XYZ. You're projecting these images onto this person already without even knowing. And at the end of the day, even if they are going to give you what you assumed, you shouldn't take it personal. Like I had said earlier, people do things to other people for many deep, dark reasons, many skeletons. And more than likely, you can always find out that what someone is doing to you, that it's hurting you, is related to something so deep that you don't even know or understand unless they explain it to you. He also goes into how we have masks. So we all know that we have on a mask, but the way he explains it is just crazy to me, because he's basically just like, okay, you're born into this world, you do things naturally the way you're supposed to, pure and happiness is all you feel, but you're surrounded by adults who are already infected by this wounded disease. So they are raising you to develop the similar fears and goals and whatever that they have already implanted in them. So already when you're becoming an older child, you're developing a mask around your parents, and then you develop another mask around your friends and peers. You know how you want to be, you know the image that you want to give to people in different settings. So let's say you meet someone and you already have two masks. So like, you know, you have your mask around your social people and you have your mask around your family. Then you meet this partner and you guys are really attracted to each other. So now it's like you show them one of your masks that you already have prepared for socially. But as you realize you like them, you're now developing a third mask. So now, and he's doing the same thing in return, or she's doing the same thing in return. Both partners are doing the same thing. Now you have six masks going at it with each other, and people wonder why relationships don't work. It's like you're never really truly yourself because there's something that you're trying to avoid. There's some type of fear that is infecting the relationship. Basically, what I got from this chapter is learning to become a master of love. It's learning to not become a master of fear, anger, and all these negative emotions that are affecting you. To not feed into that, because it affects you and it blocks you from receiving and giving love. Because you're always going to be on the defense. You're always going to take things personally. And I don't want to touch on certain things that are also in this book. So that's kind of why I'm keeping this as vague as it may seem to some people. But that's what I got. You know, the wounded mind. Our mind is wounded. We are all wounded because society is teaching us to care about certain things that may not even really matter. This is all a dream world. So that's the last thing that I'm going to leave this video with, is he touches that as well. He says that we're born into a world that has already been created, that is already a giant dream, that all the people, I guess, who have been on this planet have created together, who God or the universe has created. There is a world already for us, and it's filled with lots of beauty and love. But you can't see that because you're creating your own dream, which is also beautiful, but you could create a dream that is very painful. You could create your own dream of hell here on this earth, full of anger, jealousy, pain, and suffering, because you cannot change your mindset and you won't allow yourself to be open to love or giving love just freely without expecting anything in return. So, you know, it's up to us. We are all masters of our lives. We are all able to create a dream of our own on this planet. And it's up to you to realize how powerful you are. Whatever you're thinking can come true. So if you don't think that you're worthy of love, you will not become worthy of love. If you do not think that you can be happy, you will not be happy. If you, whatever you create in your head, real quick, last example, is in a relationship, you're sitting at home and you text your man and your man doesn't respond for hours. A lot of people, or a lot of partners, would go jump to thinking that, what is this person doing? What is my partner doing? Are they cheating on me? And then you tell yourself, no, he's not cheating on me. But the thought has already been implanted in your mind, which is why meditation is so important. It's important to keep your mind blank at times and to not allow stress to come in. So you plant it in your head that he's cheating, take it out, and then you keep putting it in, and then soon it actually manifests into your mind and becomes a whole thing. And before you know it, either you nag this person to the point where they want to cheat, or for some reason the energies make it so that this person ends up cheating. You know that these things happen. All humans are powerful. We're like magicians, literally. But we've been taught from being born immediately that this is real, this is not real, this is possible, this is not possible. And you can't do that. You have to realize that anything is possible if you truly put your mind to it. You set your mind to believe that this can happen. So just realizing how powerful your mind is really important, because whatever you think can come to reality. So if you're gonna think mostly negative things in your relationship and take everything personally and not realize that we all have our own individual lives and own individual thoughts and have our own individual worlds, then it's just not gonna work out. So I'm just gonna leave you with that. This is just the first video, so it may be a little rough, and I know I could be a lot more concise than this. So don't worry, chapter 2 will be a lot better. Chapter 2, I feel like I should tell you what the second chapter is so you guys can be prepared for anybody who's interested. Chapter 2 is called The Loss of Innocence. So if you want to hear more about this amazing book and how it has been changing my life recently, keep watching and yeah. Enjoy life.